This is Ace with Rock Revolt. I'm here with Des Fafara of Devil Driver. How's it going today, man?
Going well. Going really well. I'm in California right now at home. Sun is shining, and we're getting ready to start rehearsals for this Blackest of the Black tour that we're doing with Danzig and Ministry at the show out here in California.
Right, and Venom Inc.'s even going to be a part of that. Their only U.S. show this year.
Yeah, very cool, man. I'm real excited, and you know, the lineup is great. Obviously, we know all those bands, and so I mean, it's only 45 minutes up the road for me. I get to take the wife and the kids and go have a good time.
Right, yeah, and you don't have to, you know, pack up everything, go get on a bus and everything. You guys probably make it a pretty easy little trip, huh?
Oh yeah, it's like get a U-Haul, drive the stuff 35 minutes to the gig. I mean, it's going to be fun. I mean, even all of us are kind of set aside, like, oh, where are we going to be? I guess we got to be backstage. There's no bus. I'm like, yeah, dude, it's perfect, and I get to be home in my bed that night. You know, we're in the middle of writing and recording and doing some stuff, so it's good to go do, you know, go do a one-off, catch the vibe of the band, and then come back home that night and start work on music the next morning.
Absolutely, and like I said, you know, there's no bus or anything. That actually just gives you a chance to roam and be free, kick it with everybody, just have a good time and enjoy it.
Yeah, well, those bands specifically, you know, I'm very good friends with Al from Ministry. I mean, he was on the Vulture record, and we talk very frequently, and it's, you know, it's always nice when your heroes become good friends and they become good guys. And then Danzig, of course, it was my first tour ever. He took me out, and we've been friends ever since. So he comes out to my gigs when he can, and I go out to my gigs, and I've toured with him many times over the years. So it's going to be really cool, man. And my kids have never seen Danzig live, and my wife is a huge Ministry fan and never seen Ministry live, and I know that they're doing, their set list is like just all the hits.
Yeah.
So we can't wait. So for Blackest of the Black, it's going to be a good time, and Devil Driver's going to crush it.
Hell yeah. Yeah, I was lucky enough, I got to see Ministry last year at Chicago Open Air, and yeah, it was great. I was lucky enough to snag a picture with Sin as he was going by, so that was cool.
they're the nicest cats, man. They're you know, they bleed for their art, and you gotta love that. So it'll be cool.
Hell yeah! When you guys get done with that, this summer, this fall, you're going to be doing a hell of a lot of other gigantic festivals just on the other side of the pond.
Absolutely, very excited. I mean, we're doing Download UK, we're doing Download Paris, one of the only bands to be allowed to do Download Paris and Hellfest, because they're both French festivals.
Right.
You know, and then Metal Hammer Awards, Grass Pop, like just a ton of really cool shows. And we haven't been over there in a few years, so we're ready to do this, you know.
Yeah. What when you go overseas, you know, and you get over there, and I mean, of course, the fans, it's a whole different breed over there, man. They eat every genre of music alive, man. They don't subcategorize. They love everything, man. I mean, just the energy you guys are going to get from that's just got to be great.
I do. I enjoy it. And I'm one of those who, you know, my job affords me a few things that I really like, man, which is like, you know, meeting new people, going to new places, you know, eating new food, going to different cultures. Like that for me is just a plus in what I do. And those fans overseas have been absolutely rampant for Devil Driver. And we've kind of like, we've eased off on going over. We go over every couple of years and do festivals every couple of years. But what we're really going to do starting off with this festival run is, and starting with February, March next year, we're going to come over with a headliner with a really killer package and do all of the UK, all of mainland Europe. And then from, you know, try to get over there at least 2 to 3 times next year.
Nice.
And really, 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 really get over and work the market, which is something we haven't done in the last probably 6 or 7 years. It's a difficult, every band will tell you that it's a difficult process to go over there unless the band is functioning perfectly, everyone's getting along, you've got the great crew, because it can get pretty grindy, you know, the kind of tours we do. I mean, this one we're only going over for like 3 weeks, but usually it's, you know, we're going over for 2 months at a time. So I'm excited to get back in the market, do these festivals, totally crush it, and then come back over next year a few different times on our own, and then come back next year for the later festivals over there in August as well, because we're avoiding those this year because we did them last year.
Yeah, and like I said, I'm sure the mindset's got to be, everybody's mindset's got to be on when you do go overseas, because everyone's so far from home. You got to have all that stuff blocked out. Like I said, I'm sure it can be very taxing if it's not, you know.
look, man, it's just, it's like any machine, you know, if the carburetor's not running, the car's not going.
Right.
And so everybody has a specific function and it's all got to be going well. I mean, you know, if you know, one of the members is at home and someone, you know, a family member is in the hospital or this and that, like you don't go book those kind of tours. So everything has to be proper and going well. And I mean, right now on Trust No One with this record, this lineup, the new management, everything that we have now, it's just really been incredible. And we're booking solid. I mean, we're getting ready to, we're booking a fall tour that's going to be almost 11 weeks in the United States. We're doing Blackest. We do Chicago Open Air, which I'm so excited about to be part of. Just to be part of that lineup on Sunday is insane. And then from there, the beginning of August, we head over to South America. Next year, we've already started booking, you know, China, Japan, Singapore, Australia, more in the States, a ton more overseas, Russia at least twice next year. Like, we've got a lot of plans. Mexico City at least twice. I mean, we've got a lot of stuff.
You're getting that passport book stamped, is what you're saying. You guys are going everywhere.
that's actually funny. I just had to get it replaced, and I had one of those ones with like the thick books, and I pleaded with them to let me keep it. So they did. They punched it through and let me keep it because it was, you know, I'm just thinking of like my grandchildren's grandchildren being able to pull that out and be, you know, on March 2000 and whatever, or March 1995, whatever. You know, he came into England through Dover Pass, like that kind of shit. You always want to keep those kind of memories.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And like you were just talking about Trust No One, it's about to hit a year old, man. You guys have been pushing that album hard. It's been a very successful album for you guys, man. You guys have to be pleased with it.
You know, I am. I mean, look, in the industry of declining sales, for all musicians, it was really well received, not only by critics and the fans, but it came out the highest debut we've had. So yeah, I'm very grateful. We worked extremely hard on that record, and we found a working method on that record that now we're going to use in the future that worked really well, man. And I kind of applaud the team, not just, you know, myself, but we kind of found this way of doing things and passing stuff on to each other, as well as we don't lay a release date on ourselves anymore. You know, it's like that kind of a thing can get really crushing for an artist. It's like, come on, you've got to hurry. You have a release date. It's like, A, this is art. B, this is going to live forever. And C, no, you're not going to fucking push me anymore. You know, so we don't lay a release date on ourselves, and that's a really great thing. Like, it allows you to do the art, take time maybe on a tour to listen to a record over and over, then come back, oh, I would have done this different, I would have done that different, but you can't because it's already getting ready to release. So we make time for the art right now, and we found a really great way, like I said, of working together, and it's moving forward with the next record that we're working on now.
Now, do you look back on all these years and all these records you've made and think, God damn it, why didn't I come up with this a long time ago?
You know, look, you just got to learn, and we've had different members, and we had longtime members that were in that were just, there was just not a way we've ever found that worked as well as what's happening now. There's a situation where everybody writes, then everybody gets together, then everybody puts it all together, then everybody gives it to me, and then I lay vocal notes just on my phone, and then I send those out, and a guitar player or, you know, a drummer will come back to me and, hey, cool, I'm going to do this on the drums, do that vocally. We've really taken the time to craft our art. And I think it's really important at this point, at this juncture in our career, to have the seventh album come out, you know, higher than the rest, and to be where we're at and to be fortunate enough to have the fan base that we do. It's very critical for us to make leaps and bounds every time we do a record. So finding out this new way of working together has really been a blessing.
Oh, yeah. And Ethan, I'm sure probably the change in the music industry is probably helping that out too, because, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, it was labels trying to push things. You know, we got to go, we got to do this. You know, the industry is more of a call it do-it-yourself, DIY type thing nowadays. And I'm sure that probably helps with everything as well.
Well, you got to realize, I mean, you know, from the time I was growing up until, you know, even up to recently, I think rock and metal were like really on the forefront with youth. But that is, you know, sharply in decline. And that's just the truth of it.
Oh, yeah.
Metal is in a category like, you know, punk rock or blues, underground art, and for real. And we can't stress that enough, that keeping the art alive is going to come up to these younger bands as well, that, you know, won't play the game for radio or won't play the game for labels, and will come out DIY and really, you know, really come up with something different and keep it heavy, not just for the sake of keeping it heavy, but for keeping the art alive of heavy metal, you know? We're just trying to do our best, man. We're on track right now. We're already booking into 2019. We know what we're doing with our records that are coming out and when the next one is coming in. We've got a plan of attack that is now being just completely solidified by agents and myself. And like I said, we're with the Oracle Management now, and that's just been intense because that company is growing massively, bringing in other young managers such as like Mark Vieira with all his bands, like Black Tusk and his band. So it's, and he has Tombs. So that's, it's been incredible. And the process has been, not only extremely artistic for us, right? But the whole way has been like, okay, let's maintain our distance from all other genres. Like let's make sure that Devil Driver sounds like Devil Driver at all times and never falls into some other genre. And that, you know, that's why people call us groove metal or the groove machine. It's like, cause everybody needs a title, let's face it. You know?
Oh God, yes.
But you know, it's cool. It's like, you know, it's not like begrudgingly, it's more like, hey, I'll take that. It's like, now you go to Spotify and they have a groove metal section and like Devil Driver's on the top. You know, and I'll argue with that because there's a few other bands I think that came before us that did stuff that was metal that sounded groovy, Pantera one of them. But hey, if that's the category you want to put us in, then I'm down. So that's been enlightening, man, over the years. Like us just always having conversation about, like, you know, we may write 30 songs for a record and we may all love, you know, say track 10, but track 10 is like nothing like Devil Driver would do. So we'll alter it a little and we'll put it on the record. You know, and you're going to see a lot more from us too, of us coming out of the pocket. Because I think if you listen to any Devil Driver record, you'll be able to tell that it's us from our signature, like sound, but you're not going to, you can't compare like Pray for Villains with Beast or Beast with the Fury of Our Maker's Hands. Like you can't compare, people, the only comparison we're getting right now is like people are comparing Trust No One to our third record, Last Kind Words. And I'm like, hey, cool, because that's a favorite of people's. But we try to make sure every record is different and that we're actually doing something different. That's why we've got this thing that we're doing right now that's just so out of the pocket and so different that people are going to be tripping. So I'm waiting for this next release, you know?
Right, which you have no idea when that'll be.
Well, you know what? I do know this, right? Like the only thing I will do is let them slot in the year. So it's going to be definitely coming out the first quarter of next year.
There you go.
And for people who don't know what we're doing, we're doing an Outlaw Country cover record, but heavy as balls.
I saw that, and I thought that was interesting as hell.
Like if you go on a tour bus in the United States with metal bands, you're going to hear Outlaw Country. You're going to hear Johnny Cash. You're going to hear Willie Nelson. You're going to hear Waylon Jennings. You know, I mean, you're going to hear these artists in the back, in the front lounge, like as much as punk rock. I mean, I go from Black Flag to Hank Senior to Hank, you know, to Hank Three to fucking Ozzy, like, in an instant. Like that's my playlist. So
right.
I've always heard these songs heavy. So like when I hear like say Ghost Riders in the Sky, I'm always in the back listening to that, smoking a joint going, what would it be like to fucking hear a heavy version of this? Like, and we'll start singing it back there heavy. And you know, it feels natural to me. So we're doing 13 songs and by all outlaw artists, Johnny Cash, Willie, Waylon, Johnny Paycheck, like only the best of the best and mostly only outlaw country stuff. And there's probably 20 A level guests on this thing. I mean, Grammy Award winners. I mean, I'll give you an example now. So this is, like almost, this is definitely an exclusive. So here's the example. Like the first song that we worked on was Ghost Riders in the Sky. I went to Johnny Cash's cabin, in Tennessee. I recorded with John Carter Cash Jr. and his wife, did Ghost Riders, and now Randy from Lamb of God is going to jump on the song.
Oh, nice.
So that's just the tip of the iceberg of like artists that are on this thing. I mean, it's 20 artists, but it's turning more into like probably 25 by the time. There's people calling me daily that are jumping on this thing. I mean, the most recent cat, and he's like a hero of mine. And just to like pick up the phone and see his number calling me in the morning, like makes my 14-year-old self fucking shake. But like leave in from fear is doing two songs with me as well. So yeah. It's like, it's just become this intense thing that everyone in the industry is calling me going, wait a minute, wait, what are you doing? We just heard you, fuck, everybody should have fucking done that. And I go, well, you know, we're doing a volume one, which means A, there's a volume two coming. So if we have, you know, we don't have any more songs slotted, I'd love to have you. And I've actually had to turn some people down that were like major fucking artists just saying, we don't have room, you know? So yeah, that's part and parcel like what we do in Devil Driver. We do different shit. We want to do different shit. We want to shake it up. I want to have the metal purists go, fuck that, I don't love country, and then hear the record and go, Jesus, because it's heavy as balls.
Yeah.
Like beyond heavy as balls. Or the person who loves country that hates metal to hear it and go, Jesus, these guys did a fucking fantastic job at keeping the fucking song alive in it, you know, because we didn't go in and massacre these songs. We kept them as they are. Like Lee Ving said to me the other day, which is funny, put that in quotes. Lee Ving said to me the other day, right? Like right now, just saying that out loud is tripping my balls. But he says to me, he's like, how dare you even like change a chord? Because it's in the key of C. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. So we dropped it down a half a fucking step, listened to it. And he listened to it like, Jesus, this stuff is fucking awesome. I mean, when he heard it, he was supposed to get on one song. When he heard it, he fucking physically called me and said, I want to do three. I said, we've got two. He goes, I want to do two. I said, you're on it. Let's do it.
And you guys are probably having the time of your fucking life, too, just a ball doing this.
Yeah, because, you know, there's no expectations.
Right.
I'm not thinking like it's going to come out and outsell everything. It's going to do this and that. What it's really going to do is shake up shit.
Yeah.
And what I really want is every other band that's out there on their tour bus to fucking listen to it, because they're going to be listening to it, you know, in the back lounge before they go on, going, holy fuck, we should have done this, but you didn't. Devil Driver did.
But they're also going to be going, volume two, how the fuck do we get a hold of these guys?
Well, bro, yeah, I mean, I don't, you know, like I said, I've only dropped a few names, and I'm not going to sit here and name drop, but if I name drop the four guys I had just turned down last week, you might crawl through the phone and slap me in the face. Like, and go, what are you, fuck? You know, but I have to. I mean, they're taken.
Yeah.
Like, what am I going to do? I'm going to take somebody like Danzig and give him his tune? Like, it's not going to happen, dog. Like, so... For me, this thing has been so fun. There was no stress. I mean, Mike Spreitzer said to me, I mean, this is the second time he said it. On Trust No One, he called me and said, thank you. And I was like, for what? Because we made some member changes. He's like, this is the funnest record I've ever had the pleasure of being on. And I was like, cool. Now he just, you know, he hit me up 2 weeks ago. And he's like, let me tell you something, man. I've had the best time laying this fucking record. It's going to be called Outlaws Till the End.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Dude, that's going to be great, man. That's going to be fantastic. And just, like I said, just being able to just play with people, you know, people you've idolized, and just have fun, and just, the song's written, it's already there. You guys are just having fun, man, and laying shit down, and it's probably going to just be one of the greatest things you actually do.
I mean, it's crazy, man. Like, I send out, you know, it's like a mass, like, a paragraph that we write, you know, like, whenever we send it out to an artist, if we want them on it, right?
Right.
So I send out the same thing to everybody. But, like, to see the emails coming back, like, holy fuck, you're doing what? like, okay, wait a minute, send me a list. And then you send them the list, and they're like, I'll be on, you know, any one of these five. And I'm like, oh, shit. So now you really start to know, you're like, this guy from the metal world. this guy from the rock metal world, this guy from the punk rock world, this guy from the industrial world, this guy from the country world. I mean, like, country artists. Like, these guys all, like, fucking love country.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, the metal guys love the country stuff. The country guys that are on this record, because there's many of them, like, all love metal. So, there's just something in common, and that's how we came up with Outlaws Till the End, because there's just something in common with outlaw music, be it like fucking Ace of Spades by Motorhead or fucking Johnny Cash. Like, yep. there is something to be said for the guy in black, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And thus I've worn it my whole career. There you go.
Hell yeah. You know, it's like, dude, I saw Aaron Lewis a couple months ago do his country show. It was pretty fucking good. I'm not going to lie. I was shocked. I was really shocked.
You know, can I tell you, like, I'm friends with Aaron. I've been friends with Aaron for a long time. That second record that he put out, I'm one of the first people to hear it.
Really?
I was in Australia with him backstage, and he's like, dude, come over into my room, listen to my second record. And I'm like, I love your first one. Like, I don't care what people say. If you jump genres and you're doing it from your heart, like, I love it. So I heard that record and I was like, this is going to be a fucking hit.
Yeah.
I mean, the guy, he writes hits. I mean, let's face it. He's got George Jones on his record. Like, George Jones is not going to be on your record for any amount of money unless he thinks you're a real country artist. You know, and I got no room for the purist, because the purist guy will hear, you know, the Germs or the Circle Jerks coming out of my back room there in the bus and be like, what's this shit? You know, or the purist will hear, like, you know, Willie Nelson or Johnny Cash coming out of my back lounge and be like, what's this shit? And I'm like, dude, you know, sorry, I'm not going to play like only Satyricon, which is, by the way, a band I love, but, like, you know, sorry, like, you know, and you're going to hear some different shit. And so I've never been a purist. And that's the best thing to me, is to, like, have a couple people in the back lounge that I don't know, with somebody that comes back there to say hi to me, and I just fucking put on Bauhaus and just watch, like, after four songs, just watch their whole life melt away because they thought they were going to come in the back lounge and listen to old Metallica or whatever. You know what I mean?
They're like, Dez, who are you? What have you done? Yeah.
You know, and it is true. I will whoop up some fucking old Metallica without a doubt. No doubt. Ride the Lightning is one of my favorite records of all time. But, you know, it's pleasurable to me to fuck with people's emotions, especially if they're purists in music, because I've just never been that guy, you know, ever. So.
Oh, yeah, man, it's great. You know, like, I love blasting some Neil Diamond. Mm-hmm. People walk by my office and they're the same. They're like, what is this guy doing?
Hey, whatever. You know, dude, you got your choices. It's like, yeah. Neil Diamond's a hell of a fucking songwriter. You think the guy's got a 50-year career because he sucked?
Yeah, dude, I love Neil. I've seen him three times, man. I fucking love Neil. I really do. I absolutely love Neil.
You know, all I know, dude, you just got to be at Phil Anselmo's house and listen to him put on Echo and the Bunnymen and watch his fucking smile. Right? And that's the essence of what I'm talking about. Like, purity in music fucking sucks. You got to listen to everything. And I mean, we woke up this morning, we were listening to fucking B.B. King, you know, and it went straight into Billie Holiday. And then right after that, my girl's, I don't know, she got in a crazy, you know, she got in a mood, she fucking put on Dead Kennedys, you know, over coffee. I was like, killer.
So, anyways,
that's what goes on, man.
Right on. Hey, before I let you go and get on with the rest of your day, I want to follow up on our last time we talked. Sure. We had talked about kind of your overcoming your anxieties of being around people and starting to get into these meet and greets, and those being, you know, you said that's became one of the best parts of your day.
Totally.
And right before that, you were getting ready to board that giant ship and go do 70,000 tons of metal. So we were going to follow up and talk about you're overcoming your anxieties of meeting these people, and now you're going to go trap yourself on a cruise ship with 4,000 people. How was it, man? How was it?
Dude, it's like I get the offer, I roll over in bed, I tell my wife, this is never going to work. She's like, cool. She went out and ordered 2,500 cards, black cards with black writing that said, Dez Fafara, keep it heavy, with all my Instagram and all my shit on it, and called my agent for me and said, book it. So that's how that happened. And can I tell you, like, yeah, it's just been something since my childhood. Look, man, I suffer from ADD and ADHD. My parents had me on Ritalin for like 10, 11 years. I've always been the kid that's like, fine to play with Legos in his room by himself. I would, matter of fact, I was a kid who would, like, you know, call my mom downstairs and be like, hey, Jimmy's cussing. And Jimmy would be like, I didn't cuss. And I'd just be like, remove him. Like, I didn't want anyone ever hanging out with me. I've always been a loner. One of the first things I said to my wife when we met is like, do you have a ton of friends? Because if so, like, I don't want them in my life. Like, that's just how I am. So I keep my circle real small. And what I've realized is, yeah, we started doing these meet and greets. And they're paid meet and greets. And they help the bus get down the road and help, you know, with all the financials, et cetera. But going out for, you know, and ours aren't just like, we don't just sit behind a table and you come shake my hand, you walk by me. Like, we're hanging out. We're there for 45 minutes to an hour. We're talking about whatever, you know, kids, whatever you want to talk about. So I started realizing, like, you know, hey, because you can put me in a room with any more than 10 people, my hands start sweating and I either want to punch people or leave. And that's just the way that it is. And I started realizing, like, this is phenomenal. I'm meeting the 43-year-old guy who's bringing his 11-year-old son who grew up listening to me in Cold Chamber. I'm meeting the 17-year-old kid with his four friends that just found Devil Driver and started growing their hair out because they fucking found Devil Driver. Like, the range of people I started meeting, the stories I started hearing, the time I started having, the handshakes, the hugs that felt like real. I was like, okay, I'm never not doing. Like, this is the highlight of my day. So, yeah, I mean, you know, you just got to overcome stuff. I mean, if anybody's listening to this that actually really has social anxiety, like I do, they're going to understand where I'm coming from. But you have to step outside yourself, and you got to just, you know, put yourself in those positions. And once my wife threw me into the position, 70 tons was amazing. I mean, I did. Here's the thing. I gave away 2,500 cards. Every one of them was me pressing the flesh, me going, how you doing? Somebody approaching me at lunch, you know, because I went and ate, you know, all the other bands were eating in their rooms. I went out and ate with everybody else.
Nice.
I went to other people's shows. I went down to the bar when people were doing karaoke. Like, I made myself stay the fuck out of my room. And I gave away 2,500 of those cards, and every single one of them was a handshake or a hug. It wasn't just like, here's a stack of cards, grab one. And I told my wife, I said, thank you so much, Anastasia. I said, that's one of the best moves you ever fucking had me do. And it has me breathe a little easier now, you know, when I'm walking into a room of, you know, 50 people or whatever, first 60 people for a meet and greet, you know?
Yeah.
But those have been the best things. We've also done this thing called Roadie for a Day where, you know, you come, you get there at 11, 12 in the afternoon, you work until 2:30 in the morning with all the crew. You eat lunch with the band, you're going to see everybody, you know, all day long coming in and out of the bus. You're going to be able to, like, you know, shake hands, take photos, whatever you need all day long. And that's been just unbelievable as well. I mean, this is a great story. We've actually given people jobs at clubs because promoters will see the kid working with us and will approach him and be like, do you got a job? And it's like, no. It's like, well, I want you to come run my stage. I saw how you worked. So we've actually gotten two people jobs out of that. So
that's awesome, man. That's amazing. Yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah, it's kind of cool to do. But, yeah, that's the story on that. And now I'm loving doing that, man. It's been a great time.
Yeah, it's got to make yourself feel better too, man. You've stepped outside the box. You're doing those things. That's the human growth. You know, that's just got to, you know, on top of everything else, just help add and fuel that fire. You know.
Well, I wouldn't be anywhere in this world. I mean, I wouldn't have a house over my head if it wasn't for the people that have followed me since the beginning of my career. So that's just the bottom line. I've never been one of those guys who's ever, like, come out of the pocket and gained an ego. I mean, and that's why I still, when I work with all these people, these other artists that I'm working with, I'm still, like, in awe. You know, you got to almost tell me, well, wait a minute, dude, you're also in Devil Driver. Don't be in awe. It's like, no, wrong. I'm working with fucking heroes of mine. Like, I've never gained that outside blue-collar perspective because it's where I come from. I come from my dad was, you know, construction, you know, contractor. I was on the job since I was 17 years old. I ran away from home when I was 15. I went to prison. Like, I know the hard. I know the hard route, right? So I never got that ego thing. And I think that, you know, me not getting that, I think that's what's kept people probably following my music and definitely following my career this whole time. So, yeah, if I can ever meet them out by the bus or during a meet and greet or like on that 70 tons, it's like, of course I'm going to give you a handshake and a fucking hug. It's like, you know, hey, thanks, you know, like when I had to pay my bills when my wife was pregnant, like, you know, you bought an album, you bought a t-shirt. You know, you came to a fucking gig and paid $20 to see us. You know, we went on an hour and a half late that night because shit happened, and you still waved around. Fucking thank you. And like, if you don't have a thankful attitude in an art industry, whether you're a poet, painter, fucking prophet, you're gonna go nowhere. You're gonna go nowhere. You know, and that's just how I feel. You know?
Hell yeah, man. That's the way to be, man. That is right there. People listening, you're starting a band, you're young. Listen to what he just said and keep it real. Just like that, man. No better advice, bro. Man. That's the best advice you can give.
Oh, bro, and stay the fuck away from hard drugs. Any women that are going to be Yoko Ono, and if alcohol is causing you to fight, you better go sober, because I waited all these years to be sober off booze, and I feel better than I ever fucking have. So, yeah, stay away from all that shit. I mean, get the fuck into your music. You got to understand, though, man, when I started touring, man, I started touring with guys like Danzig or Black Sabbath that went around the world to Pantera. None of them treated us like they were rock stars. All of them invited us into catering. All of them... you know, invited us on their bus. I mean, we used to get off stage and, you know, there'd be fucking, you know, $80 in Taco Bell food from Pantera, like, every night on our bus. Like, they took care of us. Like, I never came up when dudes had massive fucking egos, you know, and now you got some bands that, like, literally, you know, they've come out of nowhere to be something in the middle of, you know, nowhere, and they've gotten big overnight, and, you know, you go to just approach them in catering and say hello, and they got no time. It's like, dude, we'll see you fall, dude. Yeah. See you in 2 years, dude. Because if you just treated me like that, or, you know, not me personally, but if you just treated the next guy like that, eventually you're going to treat too many people like that, you know?
Yeah, you're going to treat your fans like that, and you're going to, as quick as you came up, you're going to fall down even faster.
Bro, you can't do that, you know? Yeah. You can't do that. And this is why we started doing the meet and greets, too, because it's like, there's nothing fucking worse than coming off stage, cold as fuck. It's like raining and cold outside. I got 40 more shows to do. I got a towel over my head, a towel around me. There's steam coming off me. I'm trying to get to the bus, and there's 30 people outside that want to fucking talk to me. Well, you know, there's no way. I've got to get inside. I got to get my fucking hair dry so I don't catch a fucking cold. I've got to put on some fucking clean clothes because my shit's drenched. Because I don't just stand there on stage and let the fucking lights do the work for me. And I got to give myself fucking 20 to 30 minutes to get dry and get warm, and then I'll come out. And then you come out, and half of them are gone.
Yeah.
So, you know, and I've done the, like, get right off stage, sit there, sign, and fucking the next morning you wake up, you can't talk. Your throat is fucking closed, and you got 30 more shows. And I'm a guy who never canceled. I mean, people don't know this, but on the last Hatebreed run, all of Hatebreed, all of their crew, totally fucking sick for like 3 weeks. I was sick for 3.5 weeks. My whole band, my whole crew. I'm talking in bed 30 minutes before the gig, do the gig, dry off, get back in bed. That's how sick we all were. Not Hatebreed and not Devil Driver, none of the bands that got real fucking sick canceled. So, you know, that goes to be said too, that there's some form of professionalism, but you got to take care of yourself, because if you do get sick, you're all of a sudden out there for 2-3 weeks sick doing shows. And I'm going to tell you, there's nothing fucking worse. I think my family probably got the gist of it, because 2 weeks into the tour, they were all sick at home when we were all sick on the bus. And my wife said to me, I have no idea how you're going to go do a show tonight. And I was like, that's the only thing I'm living for right now.
Yeah.
The fucking show. So yeah, man, I thank anybody who's ever supported me from the very beginning up until now, of course, yeah.
Shit, yeah, man. Well, Daz, I have greatly appreciated this chat, man. It's been great, dude. I thank you so much for your time. You know, good luck overseas. Can't wait to hopefully get back here through the Midwest, come through Kansas City. That way we can definitely meet in person, you know, do our thing, man. Have a good rest of the day, dude. I greatly appreciate you.
Cool, man. No problem. I appreciate the support. And you guys can all hit me too, man, on Instagram and Twitter. I'm on there all the time talking. So feel free to hit me at Des Fafara. And I'll, you know, most of the time I'm posting pictures of my Doberman or my Great Dane. But I'll talk to you guys definitely. So thanks for the support, brother. And have a great day.
All right, man. Thank you, sir.